Namaste. In our previous video, we learned about the element of wind, that is Vayu. We had understood that Vayu features movement. This movement is met with resistance or friction, which causes thermal energy or heat to be produced. We can consider that this heat represents the third Mahabhuta, which is Agni. This is told to be the element of fire. Agni is revered to be special among the Panchamahabhutas due to its position among the five. It lies in the dead middle and acts as a fulcrum between Akasha Vayu, that is energy, and Prithvi Jala, which is matter. So, based on the above statement, is Agni both energy and matter? Let's analyze this. Energy cannot be usually visualized but can be felt or measured. Matter, on the other hand, can be visualized and are in a bound physical form. Agni is the only entity which can be visualized despite not being bound by a physical form, right? Einstein's famous equation E equal to mc square also states that energy and matter are two sides of the same coin. Energy converts into matter and matter into energy. So, we can boldly say that Agni is the factor of transformation, that is, responsible for the conversion of matter into energy and energy into matter. Let's dive right into our video now. If you haven't watched the previous videos on Vayu Mahabhuta and Akasha Mahabhuta, it is highly recommended that you watch those videos first. Simply Ayurveda is an initiative to explore and share the concepts of the vast science of Ayurveda in an easy manner. Consider subscribing to our channel. Coming to the definition of Agni, Vayorapi Vikurvanat Virochishnuhu Tamonudam. According to this sloka, Vayu, when transformed into a form which is bright or glowing that destroys all tama or darkness, is Agni or Teja. Vayor Agni. This sloka from Taittiriya Upanishad states that Agni is formed from Vayu. This concurs with that we explained previously. Vayu Mahabhuta is movement. Any kind of movement, when arrested or met with resistance, leads to production of energy in the form of heat, light, etc. This energy corresponds with Agni Mahabhuta. It is the catalytic agent which causes change or conversion in this universe. The characteristic feature of this Mahabhuta is explained as Tejasaha Ushnata. Heat is the characteristic feature of Tejas or Agni. Let us now understand Agni Mahabhuta in detail with the explanation from Tarka Sangraha. Ushnasparshavat Tejaha Tad Dvividam Nityam Anityam Cha Nityam Paramanu Rupam Anityam Kadi Rupam Tad Punastrividam Sharira Indre Vishayabhedat Shariram Aditya Loke Indriyam Rupagrahakam Chakshuhu Krishna Tara Agravartihi Vishayas Chaturvidaha Bhauma Divya Audarya Akaraja Bedat Bhaumam Vanyadikam Agni Pradhanam Divyam Vidyudadi Bhuktasya Parinama Hetor Audaryam Akarajam Suvarnadi. Agni is that which has hot touch. It exists in two functional states, Nityarupa, which is eternal and atomic, and Anityarupa, which is Karyarupa, which is created from the Paramanus. This Karyarupa, which is perishable, is of three forms, Sharira, Indriya and Vishaya. The bodies which are Tejasya is explained as Aditya Loke. This includes all the stars, planets and even the sun. Chakshur Indriya, which is located in the Netra, is said to be the Tejasya Indriya. This is responsible for perception of sight. Tejasya Vishaya are of four types. Bhauma, or earthly fire, which includes the source of heat produced in the earth like fossil fuel, lava and even hot springs and gases. Divya, or celestial fire, includes lightning, which is born out of Akasha or the sky. Audarya, or gastric flame, is present in the udara or abdomen of the body, which is the cause for transformation or digestion and metabolism. Akaraja, or the mineral fire are seen in the products of the mine. They include gems and metals and other minerals. This concludes the explanation of Agni Mahabhuta according to Tarkasangraha. Agni is a mind-boggling element as it is both an element formed from other sources and is also a catalyst for transformation and creation of new entities. This is an example where the creation itself becomes the creator. When an individual does tapas, he becomes capable of production of a state of energy which enables him to be independent of the energies around him and acts as a catalyst for transformation that he or she initiates. This is similar to Agni. The above statement may be considered baseless by those who do not understand its depth. Tapas word again includes tapa or heat, which is a key attribute of Agni. Hence, during tapas, transformation from physical beings to realized beings takes place by virtue of Agni Tattva. This can be proven by understanding the principles of quantum superposition and quantum entanglement. Do look into them and try to correlate the same. These principles also prove why Taila, Agrita and Madhu are the choice of drugs for Vata, Pitta and Kapha doshas respectively. The concept of Prabhava can also be understood easily by learning this. When learning about Agni, it is important to understand Jataragni, Dhatvagni and Bhutagni. They are just clinical divisions to be understood logically and not to be correlated directly to stomach enzymes, liver metabolism, etc. As told by Acharya Vaghbhata, increase or decrease of Dhatvagni depends on the Kayagni or Jataragni. This works based on a simple feedback system regulated by the vayus. Whenever we consume some heavy food, the grahani, which is the reservoir of Jataragni, is not able to digest this. The vatas send a message to all the cells that grahani is not able to digest the food, and hence whatever circulating is pretty much unbroken, undigested stuff and not to metabolize this undigested stuff. Thus the cells slow down their metabolic activity and are not nourished enough. They remain unnourished. And unless the unbroken matter gets digested, the cells end up metabolizing them, causing all the metabolic diseases in the long run. The Dhatvagni acts in a cellular level and are classified into 7. They basically transform Aharasa into Dhatus or one Dhatu to another. It's basic sense that Bhutagni, which causes Mahabhuta breakdown, also occurs simultaneously in a quantum level, because Dhatus are made of Mahabhutas. Hence, Bhutagni is a Sukshma form of Dhatvagni, which in turn is a Sukshma form of Jataragni, which all do their function of transformation almost simultaneously. Let's now look into some additional facts about Agni Mahabhuta. In our previous videos, we looked into the lohas explained for correcting the defects in Akasha and Vayu Mahabhuta in the Sharira. Among the Pancha lohas, Tamra or copper is that which regulates Agni Bhuta in the Sharira. Its clinical application is fascinating because it acts in some praptis that involve both Kshaya and Vriddhi, because it primarily acts as a catalyst and is responsible for the conversion of energy or Vata dynamics into matter or Kapha dynamics. That is, Agni allows for the burning of excess Kapha Prithvi and also the simultaneous stimulation of Akasha Vayu. Ardraka acts in a similar way. It works on both Vibandha and Atisara. How? It does Bedana of Mala by virtue of its Ushna Tikshna Guna, similar to unclogging of pipes using acid, and also does Vatanulomana by stimulating peristalsis, again by virtue of its Gunas. In case of Atisara, it does Shoshana of Dravamala by its Gunas and stops the excess passage of stools. Among the platonic solids, tetrahedron represents Agni Bhuta. It is a four-faced triangular pyramid. This mudra is used to worship Agni Mahabhuta in the Indian culture. In order to limit the length of this video, it is advised to revise the concepts on your own. Apologizing for the same. If you like this video, hit the like button and comment your opinions. Consider subscribing to our channel and also follow us on Instagram and Facebook.